As General Nambiar mentioned, actually, we talk of the line of control a little loosely, the LOC. The LOC actually came into being only as a result of this Simla agreement. Before that, it was the ceasefire line, and it continued as the ceasefire line. And it was tweaked a little bit here, and it was tweaked a little bit there. After the 65 war, for instance, we had taken over Haji Pir, adjoining Udi, which is a very crucial pass because it connected Udi with Punch. And as a result of the Tashkent Agreement, that was handed back to Pakistan. Again, as General Nambiar said, Lal Bahadur Shastri was hero worshipped by the army. And they say, after the Tashkent agreement, Lal Bahadur Shastri suffered a heart attack. So, 65 happened. And then, 71 happened. And again, there was a little tweaking here and there, up in the north, in the Kargil sector. And that is, again, where Musharraf tried to come through in 1999. That NJ of 1842, and beyond that, up to the glacier. So, but I'd like to come back to 1972, because I think that is when the ceasefire line was formally recognized as the line of control. But there's a little more to that story. Of course, the point about handing over 92,000 soldiers is well taken, and I've been asked this question many times, and my only response has been that I think Bhutto was able to charm Mrs. Gandhi, and in her generosity and graciousness, she said, okay. But there was Bhutto's side of the bargain, which is not spoken about, which was not written down. And that was, the understanding was that when the ceasefire line is now converted formally into the line of control, and then gradually, both sides will recognize this as the international border. And that is why Dr. Farooq Abdullah has been saying since possibly 1972 or whatever, that the only solution to Jammu and Kashmir is to convert the LOC into the international boundary. Pakistan keeps what it has, and we keep what we have. Vajpayee, as Prime Minister, was very keen to end this permanent confrontation with Pakistan, for peace with Pakistan. In fact, in Lahore, in February 99, he said, one of the things he said was, ke Mia sahab aur humne faisla kar liya ki hum jang na hone denge. So there was some forward movement. And it continued during the UPA government. And when Dr. Manmohan Singh, just before remitting office, when he said that we had almost reached an agreement with Pakistan, whatever the details of that agreement may have been, ultimately it came down to the same thing. To accepting the LOC as the international boundary. So that's where it is, that's where it lies. There is one other thing, that whether it was 47, whether it was 65, 65 of course was Operation Gibraltar, the Pakistan used tribals and raiders and whoever it was to go into Kashmir, and then they would follow. Now, the interesting thing here is that When militancy began in Kashmir in 88-89, the Kashmiri believed in early 1990 that they had a chance, they might get Azadi. Because that is what people across had been telling them. You go, start this thing, and we will come as we always do. But they didn't come. So therein lies a question that why was 88, 89, 90 different from 1965? Was it that by then Pakistan had realized that there was no traction, nothing to be gained by war with India? Or were there other forces at work at that time? I'm just being provocative, but it's a thing I think we need to ponder over. Because I can't forget that during the early years of what we call insurgency, terrorism, militancy, the Kashmiris like to refer to it as their movement, the Americans were extremely, extremely supportive of it. They always referred to them as freedom fighters. And the American interest in Kashmir continued as long as the JKLF was in play. And when the JKLF began to lose out, and when the Kashmiri began to realize that there was nothing to be gained from violence and militancy and whatever, then the Americans also have backed off. And now you rarely have an American ambassador visiting Kashmir. But in those days, it happened frequently. And it happened most when those foreign hostages were taken by Al-Farhad. I think, to sum it all up, war hasn't served anybody's purpose, not even the Kashmiris. And I think people have begun to realize all over the world that war is only the last worst option. As far as the border goes, and very briefly, on the nature, the character of terror and militancy that we have in J&K, it's clearly divided along the Pir Panjal. What you see north of Pir Panjal is dying out, actually died out a long time ago, but there are still remnants of it. That is now mostly indigenous. Of course, Pakistanis do come in. There is little bits of Lashkar and Jaish and whatever, but more Kashmiri boys. And I think that's something we need to worry about. South of the Pir Panjal, it's almost totally Pakistani. And that is why we've been having these attacks in the past few years, along the international border in Jammu, and now it's moving on to Punjab. We've had two attacks in Punjab. Of course, we could argue that it'll hold at Pathankot because that route that they have taken twice is a much used route. It's the old smuggler route. It's the route which is used by drug smugglers now. It's also the route which the Babar Khalsa used to take, and so many others. But I shudder to think what would happen if four boys hijacked a vehicle, even if it's at Pathankot, and brought along the GT road and attacked our cantonment in Jalandhar or even Ambala, then how would Delhi react? I think these are some things we need to think about. You know, the difference between the international border and the line of control is quite obvious. And most of it happens in army-controlled areas, Punch and Rajouri. That's where most of the intelligence games are played out, north of Punch, that Mandi area and even further north. And if you come down to Rajouri, you have Bhimber Gully and so many other routes, and it goes on. And earlier, in North Kashmir also, Kupwara, Baramula, but now the more frequented routes are still through Punch and Rajouri.